Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Mr. Lewis Brown.
It's a pleasure to be here with you, and it's a joy to hear about all the amazing things happening at Ave Maria University. I can't thank you enough for your kind words, Roger Nutt. Thank you, President Mindendorf. Amazing what you've done, Michael, and amazing what the professors and what you all are doing. I can't thank you enough. I also want to thank Julie, if she's here, for her extraordinary kindness and hospitality, which is so vital, and I'm sure her leadership as chief of staff is amazing from what I've seen here at Ave Maria University. I also want to thank Christy for all of her help and just getting everything together, and I have a lot coming at me, and sometimes I'm not great. I also want to thank my sister, who is amazing and beautiful and wonderful, and coming down here. She serves as an attorney within the church. I'll leave it at that. She's amazing, and also my mom. I'll thank them a little bit more. I'm here for you. I'm here to serve you all, particularly the students and the faculty, and I've thought and prayed and reflected a ton about this address to you all, and I'm excited to give it to you now. All good things come from the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit through the Blessed Mother, and I invite you to help me to begin by praying with me to the Holy Spirit, the prayer to the Holy Spirit, the Veni Creator Spiritus. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful, and enkindle in us the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and you shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. Amen. And we shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. Brothers and sisters, I'm a Catholic man who, despite my sins and failures, loves Jesus Christ. I love him because he loved me first. And he is love itself. What could be better? I'm an attorney by training, and over the last 15 years, as Dr. Nutt explained, I've worked in private law practice, served in roles in government and politics, and in pro-life Catholic healthcare. I'm blessed, as Dr. Nutt explained to you, to serve as the executive director of the Christ Medicus Foundation, a Catholic healthcare ministry, where, as Dr. Nutt mentioned, our mission is to share the healing love of Christ in healthcare. We share the divine physician at Christ Medicus. It's important that I tell you a little bit about what we do, and it has a lot to do with my talk to you all this evening. We share the love of Christ in three ways. First, we defend the religious freedom and medical conscience rights of pro-life medical professionals, religious sisters, Catholic medical centers, Catholic therapists, so that they can be the instruments of the divine physician, Jesus Christ, for the healing and wholeness of their patients and hopefully of our culture. We also advise and help expand pro-life healthcare centers that care for, accompany, and heal pregnant women and their unborn children. We also provide the Curo healthcare ministry that pays for the medical cost and provides Christ-centered health coaching, spiritual direction, and a spiritual health program for the whole health and healing of our individuals and families in over 40 states. And as I've been able to say, our membership for folks that participate in our programs, their lives are transformed by a deeper encounter with Christ and the wholeness of who they are. At Christ Medicus, we help individuals not only participate in sharing their pro-life healthcare costs, but again, that deeper healing by a deeper encounter with Christ that impacts not just their health, but their whole lives. I'm so grateful that we're joined today by our extraordinary chief operating officer, an attorney, a lawyer, amazing Catholic man, Willie Cueto, and his wife, Desi. And I'm so grateful also for the Giegers that live here in town, Mike Gieger and his amazing wife, and the Donovans, Ryan and January Donovan, for also joining me. I'm also blessed to be a co-founder of the Catholic Healthcare Leadership Alliance, to be a new voice for Catholic healthcare in the United States. So needed right now. What we're doing with the Healthcare Leadership Alliance is defending the dignity of the human person in healthcare, defending religious freedom, and expanding Catholic healthcare so it can extend the divine physician to all people in our country. Brothers and sisters, I come to you as a Catholic brother in the Lord. I come to you as a fellow sinner. I come to you knowing that I truly deserve, and I mean this, I truly deserve death because of the countless sins and offenses against God and neighbor that I have committed through my life. That's true. That's true. But I also come to you knowing that I truly, truly, truly know that God has rescued me, He has healed me, He has delivered me. I come to you knowing that because of Jesus Christ's divine love and mercy, our Lord has rescued me from the eternal death I deserve and offers me eternal life. And praise God, I will have eternal life with my beloved if I persevere in a loving relationship with him to the end of my earthly pilgrimage. I come to you as a Catholic man who Jesus Christ has rescued. I come to you as a Catholic man who Jesus Christ has commanded, as he commands all Christians, to go out to be instruments of healing and rescue for all God's people, all humanity. I come to you as a Catholic man who has been commissioned as a disciple of Christ, as all baptized Catholics are commissioned, and to be an instrument of the divine physician's healing love that can deliver and free all humanity. We heal, we are instruments, if we take God's call, his invitation to heal and deliver humanity, we can be instruments of healing our brothers and sisters in our country and across the globe from the clutches of death, disease, brokenness, despair, isolation, ugliness, tragedy, and destruction that is so much greater after the last 3 years of the public health crisis for various reasons. And I come to tell you, the only thing I want you to take from my biography is this. I come to tell you that after 15 years, not that long, but you know, I'm not a kid anymore. After 15 years of doing what I've done, living much of my professional dreams, after this, I know only one thing matters. The priority in my life, and what should be the priority in your life, is perseverance and relationship with Jesus Christ. That's it. Jesus Christ is the priority. He's not just the Lord King, but he's also the love of your life and my life. He's the only thing that you really need today and every day. He comes to you as your lover, your healer, your restorer. Jesus Christ comes to deliver you from all fear, from all wounds, and to make you brand new, truly brand new, beyond your greatest hopes, dreams, and imaginings. He comes to give you freedom and liberation through the fullness of relationship with him. And the fullness of your relationship with Jesus Christ can only be fully found, through the Catholic Church that our Lord founded himself. And this is why religious freedom is so vital to defend, because it is the freedom to share the healing love of God. This evening, I'm going to tell you about religious freedom, the healing freedom of God. I plan to share with you a bit about my story. I also dare to tell you a little bit about your story. We'll discuss the serious challenges to religious freedom and human dignity, our highest call. I'll talk particularly about the attacks on healthcare. And I'll share with you a little bit about how I believe Jesus Christ is calling us to share his divine mercy and love in America. I grew up in the suburbs of Detroit. Michael and I are both from the Detroit area. The son of two amazing parents who fell in love while in college in the early 1970s and were married not long after. My outstanding mother, again, Sharon, who is here with us, is a lifelong faithful Catholic. My father grew up as a Methodist, but deeply admired the Catholic faith and went to Mass with my mother and our family every Sunday. I was born in 81, and my amazing, beautiful sister was born the following year. My father was a walk-on. I think a lot of athletes here. My father was a walk-on on the football team at a Division I school in Michigan. And he had an intellectual side and became an accountant. My mother became an English teacher. My parents had an extraordinary marriage steeped in faith in God and love for each other. When I was 2 years old on a family road trip in a mobile home to Oklahoma in 1983, my father fell asleep at the wheel and the mobile home went over in an embankment and he was instantly killed. Truly miraculously, the rest of our family, my mother, my sister, grandparents, my uncle, we all survived. I do not remember my father, but I do recall that by the age of 3, I knew he was not there, and by the age of 5 at least, I understood that he had passed away. Because of the loss of my biological father, in many ways, I was more aware of God's direct, active presence in my life. Though I was deprived of my biological father, I thank God that he gave me the opportunity to experience him more directly and more potently as my spiritual father. From a young age, I had a strong sense that has never really left me, that God was always present at every moment of my life, orchestrating my life to his purposes as long as I trusted him. While my faith in God was strong, I often just went through the motions of practicing my faith. My mother was and still is a spiritual enforcer, and you can think of a supermom on the good days and a mama bear version of the Terminator on the bad days. I'm grateful for this. However, my faith needed to become my own, and it did in the fall of 1997, my junior year at Brother Rice, when I attended the Kairos retreat in Bloomfield Hills, Michigan. Kairos is Greek for God's time, and one night during that retreat, during the first snow of the year, I went to a beautiful grotto of the Blessed Mother, kneeled silently, and powerfully experienced the supernatural reality of God's presence. During that retreat, my faith became my own. Yet despite the strong conversion in high school, I got into college and I began the party lifestyle. I lived much of those years as a pagan. I was not in a state of grace most of this time. It's a sad, tragic thing. In law school, though I was generally very serious about my studies, I largely was seeking to serve my own prideful ambitions, and to my mother and sister, I am so sorry for that. Instead of chasing Jesus Christ, I was chasing power, pride, self-reliance, professional advancement, vanity, influence, sinful pleasure. I knew Jesus Christ was Lord, and I knew the path was wrong, but I didn't care. I wanted to do things my own way. However, during the end of law school, I went through a particularly challenging period. I realized the emptiness of following the path of pleasure. I began to realize the emptiness of following the path of prideful ambition and power. I realized that the only thing that I can fully rely on in this life is God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I began to understand that in this life, everything is passing away and only God remains. I understood that God is all I want, that he's all I need, and in the words of the incredible book by Dr. Ralph Martin, God is, was, is, will always be the fulfillment of all of my desires. As I studied for the bar exam for the first time ever, I began to frequently go to confession. I started going to Mass during the week. And despite my serious sins and failures, even along the way, even to this day, I'm very imperfect. I've tried to intentionally seek Jesus Christ ever since. After this deeper adult reversion in 2007, I began to realize I had never really dealt with the pain of losing my father at a young age. My realization came in two ways. First, in 2008, I was in a different place politically at the time, and I was in Washington, D.C. for the inauguration of then-President Obama. And I was in a Senate subcommittee in a party with colleagues. And I saw a buddy of mine, a very masculine guy who at the time was in his early 30s, cuddling with in a very natural way. He was cuddling with his father. It was very natural. And I saw that, and I was jealous. And that jealousy shocked me. Where in the world is that coming from? I knew I never had a memory of cuddling with my father that I could remember, but I was shocked that I was experiencing jealousy. A few more years later, in 2013, I was watching the film The Place Between the Pines, starring Bradley Cooper and Ryan Gosling, an incredible film about two boys longing for their father's love. As the film ended, I found myself uncontrollably sobbing. Why? Because the film's depiction of the search of one young man for his father so mirrored my search for my own father. After the film, and I called my sister, and Danielle, you remember this, I sobbed with so much grief that you would have thought my father had died that very day, not 29 years before. So what happened? Over the next 8 years, God took me on an ongoing, incredible journey of healing, restoration, and leadership. He took me on that journey through showing me that I'm truly an adopted son of the Father, that he is the Father behind me, bestowing upon me and you and all his children a divine inheritance. God showed me that if we persevere in relationship with him, we are eternally safe and secure, which is literally everything. His love is everything. God took the pain of the death of my father, a certain long Lent, a certain suffering, a certain cross, and made that very cross the very instrument for my ongoing personal resurrection through his healing love. God took my primary cross, the death of my biological father, and through his healing love, made me an imperfect instrument of healing, identity, and freedom for others. As psychologist and author Dr. Bob Schutz of the John Paul II Healing Center in Tallahassee often says, Christ transforms the source of our deepest woundedness into the place of our greatest healing for others. This is what God does, and this is who he is. The cross with which Christ was crucified becomes the instrument of redemption for all mankind. As Christ teaches and Dr. Schutz writes powerfully, our Lord takes our greatest woundedness and even our gravest sins and transforms that woundedness and that sinfulness into the pathway for our healing, our resurrection, and for our new eternal life. God revealed to me, he is my Father. He loves me completely and totally. He revealed to me that his love is my deepest longing. He revealed to me that his love is pure gift. I don't have to earn it. The most profound turning point came when I attended a Life in the Spirit seminar at Christ the King Catholic Church in Ann Arbor, Michigan, and received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We're only baptized once, but we can always pray for God to give us more of the Holy Spirit to unleash those gifts that are dormant for various reasons. This night in 2013, several men who, except for one, I cannot even really remember, maybe two, these men prayed over me that the Holy Spirit would more fully unleash the spiritual gifts that God gave me at baptism. At that moment, my life changed. I felt a deep peace come over me. I felt as though something in my windpipe was dislodged and I could breathe more deeply and peacefully. That day was the beginning of a new Pentecost for me. Contrary to what you might be thinking, this is not just the experience of a so-called charismatic Catholic. Rather, this is a gift available to all Catholics. It was a profound encounter with the Holy Spirit, the love of Jesus Christ and the Father, and through this encounter, a dynamic beginning, new beginning of a personal, living, breathing relationship with God. By encountering his love, we are healed. We're healed of our worries, our anxieties, our fears, our traumas, our rejections, and our disappointments. I know I had an amazing time at Michigan State, but I know college can be hard, particularly after 3 years of what we've been through. You have the opportunity to experience this right now. Living life fully alive, which is what you're called to do, means living in the reality of Pentecost, the reality that for all Catholics, being a son or daughter, means you have divine life and power from God dwelling in you now, that you can present and encounter the supernatural reality of God active in your life. You have been adopted as sons and daughters of God, and if you haven't yet, or if you are now, you need to continue to live life fully alive with God. This is my story, but it's also your story. It's your story. Like Michelangelo's painting of the creation of Adam in the Sistine Chapel, God is calling you to a beautiful, profound, adventurous, challenging, ultimate, healing, and liberating life with him who is love. You are sons and daughters of God. This is your core identity. You will never be more valuable than you are right now. You can save the world 100 times over, be president of the United States, or a CEO, but you will never be more valuable than you are right now. Why? Because your life, your value is not found in what you do, your bank accounts, your job titles, the number of your degrees, as wonderful as those things are, or your temporal power. Your value isn't there, it never will be. It's an empty chase if you're chasing that. Your value is found in the fact that God made you, he loves you, he created you for love. Your value is found in the fact that God has given you this life as pure gift for the purpose of one day returning home to him. You, brothers and sisters, are made to live life fully in the live, in the words of St. Irenaeus. You are sons and daughters of God. Before all else, you are His. You belong to God. Now, what does this look like? What does this look like? I encourage you now, as you start your academic year, encounter Christ, frequent the sacraments, go to confession regularly, try to go once a month, once every 2 months, stay in a state of grace, spend time in silence and meditation, use the Adoration Chapel, wear it out. Spend time with the Lord. Find a community of friends that love God above all else and love you as well and will accompany you. I encourage you to check out Dr. Schutt's book, Be Healed, to read The Power of Silence by Cardinal Seurat, to read Interior Freedom and the works of Father Jacques Philippe. You're in a wonderful adventure. God is reaching out to you today, every day, to be His adopted sons and daughters, to live life fully alive with Him. So what does this have to do with religious freedom? It has everything. It has everything to do with religious freedom. Religious freedom is the freedom to love. You are being commissioned in your personal and professional vocations as you go on to be instruments of God's healing power, to be instruments of divine life, to be instruments in the gospel in every aspect of your life, both as fathers and mothers, as religious sisters, as priests, as a president of the United States, as senators, congresspeople, doctors, stay-at-home mothers, across the board. You're called to share the gospel. This is the gospel. You're called to live it. You're called to share it. Your encounter with Christ will free you to set the world ablaze and will empower you to not only love and care and heal the broken world, but to be healed as well. In living out your personal professional vocation, you will be using your God-given religious freedom. Sadly, however, this is under extraordinary attack. We see religious freedom in healthcare, which is what I'm going to focus on, this evangelization, the proclamation of the gospel in healthcare. We see it lived out powerfully today. We see it in the Sisters of Perpetual Adoration of St. Francis, who run 13 hospitals, who are in perpetual adoration, serving not just the wealthy and healthy, but the sick and the suffering. We see this in the work of folks like Sister Dee Dee Byrne, who's a double board certified medical doctor and a colonel in the Army, who serves the poor, who serves migrants in Washington, D.C. We see this freedom to love lived out in countless pregnancy centers and pro-life medical clinics across our nation. We see in the healthcare industry doctors, nurses, Catholic therapists proclaiming the love of God, rescuing people who are afflicted, who are traumatized, who are broken, and lifting them up, making them brand new, truly resurrecting them. We see this all across our country. Sadly and tragically, this religious freedom is under attack. What I just told you, there's forces in our country, in our nation, that want to make the proclamation of the gospel illegal in healthcare, that want to stop you and me from proclaiming the gospel, from exercising our religious freedom in the places of brokenness and trauma and woundedness and addiction in our world today. And we have to fight it. I'm gonna just take 2 minutes here, 2-3 minutes, and tell you what that looks like and tell you how we have to respond. Most of Western society right now is driven by a culture of death, deceit, and destruction that hates God, that hates the biological, scientific reality of the human body, and wants to deceive us through 3 lies. The first lie is that God does not exist, and nothing matters, and there's no point to life. The second lie is that if God does exist, He does not love you, you cannot trust Him, and you should take matters into your own hands. The third lie is that you can actually be God. And this culture of death, destruction, and deception is doing everything it can to suppress religious freedom, to eradicate the love of God in society, and ultimately to destroy the human freedom to love. We must celebrate the extraordinary triumph of the Dobbs decision that overruled the false right to an abortion, that showed us there never has been a constitutional right to an abortion, and said that constitutional rights must be ordered in liberty. True liberty, ordered liberty. Yet the Dobbs decision has sparked an enormous attack on the proclamation of the gospel, on the dignity of God's children in healthcare. We're seeing the pro-abortion industry band together with the current presidential administration over the last 8 weeks alone to coerce medical professionals and hospitals to perform abortions, to mandate unethical and harmful transgender procedures throughout the American health system, to eliminate conscience rights and religious freedom in healthcare, and set up a regulatory framework that would make Catholic medical centers, Catholic hospitals, practicing Catholic mental health therapy illegal in the United States over time. This effort from the pro-abortion industry and from other forces in our country is part of a larger movement to reject God, to proclaim man as the new God, to create a secular religion which man himself is God, and to sow in society a hatred for the biological scientific reality of the human body. It is an unleashing of a hatred for the good, the true, and the beautiful, and an elevation of disorder, ugliness, and death. These are the aims of this advancing secular atheism, where the state usurps the role that God alone has, where the state attempts to be God in a Luciferian way. What we're seeing is a destruction of human freedom that breeds domination, revenge, envy, hatred, and wrath. It objectifies a human person as an object of the state the same way predatory capitalism, without Judeo-Christian virtue, objectifies the person as an object of the economy. Why am I telling you this? Why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this for two reasons. I told you all this first in hopes that you know that the gospel is true. In the depths of your heart, that God loves you. He's got you. He is trustworthy. And having relationship with him is the only thing that matters. That true womanhood is depend on God for everything and rescue your brothers and sisters from the gates of hell. That's the priority. Your value is found in God's love for you and the fact that you exist, and that's the call. The second reason I'm telling you all of this is because our fellow citizens across America yearn to know my story. They yearn to know your story. They yearn to know the true story of God's love for them. This is simply the gospel. All Americans and all humanity, more than anything else in this life, long for the love and mercy of God. Your second objective, your priority is to get home to God. The second objective in this life is to be instrument of God's healing, an instrument of God's healing for your brothers and sisters, to rescue them from the grips of the evil one, delivering them into the healing arms of the Lord. This is true leadership. All true leadership ultimately carries people to the good, the true, and the beautiful, and ultimately leads them to Christ. This is your call. This is your lifelong call to be healed and to go out to heal others and to defend your religious freedom to do it. This is your call to exercise the gift of religious freedom. True leadership is loving those in your care and delivering them to Christ, who is love itself. Who doesn't want that? In the final analysis, my brothers and sisters, my dear friends, nothing else matters. You are his. Remain in him. Remain in God's love. Let him heal you lifelong. Let him heal and restore others through you. God wants his children back, and he wants to rescue them through all of you. Do this, and you will be a victor. You, through God's grace, will be victorious forever. Thank you. Know for the rest of the year of my ongoing prayers for you throughout this academic year. God bless you through the intercession of our Blessed Mother, Ave Maria, thank you.